السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة العالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، ثم أما بعد، مرحبا بكم معنا أيها الإخوة الأحبة الكرام في هذا اللقاء الطيب المبارك ومع هذا الموضوع الآن، تربية الأولاد في الإسلام.
بسم الله، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. شيخ حفظه الله تعالى أستاذ تركيز من الله سبحانه وتعالى سيدنا السلام ذكر النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we'd like to welcome all of you for attending this important lesson of how to nurture our children in Islam.
بالأمس تكلمنا عن نقطة هامة جدا ألا وهي غرس العقيدة والإيمان في نفس الولد.
Yesterday's lesson, we spoke about a very important topic, and this is how to nurture, to instill the correct belief in the hearts of the children.
واليوم إن شاء الله سنتكلم عن نقطة كذلك مهمة وهي النقطة 26.
And today, inshallah, we'll talk about another important point, which is the 26th point, inshallah.
وهي غرس الأخلاق الحميدة في نفس الأولاد.
And this is to instill honorable manners within the child.
كما اتفقنا، معظم ما تريد أن توصله لولدك لابد أن تتحلى به أولاً، وهو يراك أنت تفعل هذا قبل أن تأمره بأن يفعل مثل ما تأمر.
So we've agreed from the previous sessions we've had that anything that you want to instill in your child or you want your child to be upon, you have to adorn yourself with these mannerisms or these characteristics first and foremost.
فأولا يربيه على الصدق.
So first of all, you nurture your child to be someone who's truthful.
فعندما يتصل فيه أحد لا أو ينادي عليه أحد من خارج المنزل لا تقول له أبي غير موجود، قل له أبي غير موجود، أو قل له أبي نائم، أو قل له أبي مريض، أي شيء من هذه الأشياء، هذا هدم عملي للقيم والمبادئ.
So, for example, every time someone calls the house, someone from outside, and is asking for their father, do not say to your children to say to them that my father is not here or my father is outside. When you're actually in the house, because this is something you are instilling within that child, mannerisms of having to lie, to tell lies.
ومن أكثر الأشياء التي تدعو الأولاد للاتصاف بصفة الكذب. الخوف الشديد من الأبوين.
And one of the reasons that causes children to start lying or to adopt these mannerisms of lies is the severe fear they have towards their parents.
فأنت تؤصل فيه أن يتكلم بالصدق مهما كانت العواقب.
So you nurture them to always be people or to always be telling the truth, no matter what the end result is going to be.
وأنه طالما قال الصدق والحق فإن ذلك ينجيه في العموم وكذلك ينجيه من عقوبة الأبوين.
So once you nurture them and you let them understand that every time they ask for something, they should always tell the truth, because that with the end result will always protect them from the punishment and even from their parents becoming angry with them.
كذلك نربيه على الأمانة.
And to also instill them to have trustworthy, to be trustworthy.
ونؤصل فيه أن الأمانة ليست محصورة في الماليات فقط.
And to make them understand that being trustworthy is not to do with monetary affairs or dealing with money.
وإنما الأمانة أنه إذا كلف بأي مسؤولية فهي من الأمانة.
So you make them understand that any responsibility that they are assigned to do, then that requires a certain amount of responsibility and trustworthiness.
وإذا ائتمنه أحد على سر فإنه من الأمانة.
So if someone was to trust them with a secret, That is an amana, that's the trust that they have to keep.
وغيرها كثير كثير من الصور في صفة الأمانة.
And there's so many examples, numerous examples that we can paint to show the importance of being trustworthy.
وكذلك يربيه على الاستقامة.
And to also nurture them to be upon steadfastness.
التربية العملية أولا ثم التربية بالكلام ثانيا.
To nurture them first of all with the actions that they have to come with, and then also the actions or the etiquettes of speech.
فقلنا أن في الغالب الولد هو نسخة للأبوين. في الغالب يكون نسخة للأبوين.
So most of the cases, my dear brothers and sisters, the child is going to be like almost a copy of the parents. They're going to adopt the same characteristics as the parents.
فإن لم تستقم أنت من أجل نفسك فاستقم من أجل ولدك.
So if you don't keep them firm upon the path you want them to be, then they will choose another path to be upon.
كذلك الإثار أن يؤثر غيره على نفسه.
And also to have preference, to know that they can, for example, what they want for themselves, also want it for others.
وبداية هذا أن تجعله لا يستأثر بشيء لنفسه. يعني إذا كان معه شيء من حلوى أو طعام دائما يعطي من حوله، يعطي أبوي ويعطي إخوته، بالأخص إن كان ليس معهم مما هو معه.
Especially, for example, if he happens to have something within, you know, with himself, he should not just think about myself, that greed, but rather should also think about the others, especially if they don't have what he has.
والله يا إخواني نعرف بعض الأولاد لا يأكل أي شيء أبداً إلا مع أسرته.
There are, as the Sheikh is saying, that he knows certain children that they will not eat anything except in the presence of their families.
فإن أعطيته أي شيء يضع في جيبه.
So if you were to give him something, however how small it is, you put it in his pocket.
مهما كان صغيرا.
However how small it is, he is.
وحتى يذهب إلى البيت ويقتسمه مع إخوته.
Until he returns to his home, to his house, and he will distribute it among his family.
كذلك تعلمه أن المال الذي معه لابد أن يجود به. يؤثر غيره بهذا المال بالأخص عندما يكون له حاجة بهذا المال.
And also the money that he could have, you know, you make him understand to teach them that money, yes, he can benefit from it. But if someone outside is in need of it, then he can also give them so they can benefit from that money.
وأنه متى وجد إنسان في الأسرة أو في الخارج محتاج لأي شيء وهو يستطيع أن يساعده لابد أن يقدم هذه المساعدة دون أي تردد.
So every time this child will see anyone who's even from outside his family or outside or even within the family itself, and they know that they're in need of something, he will always be at the forefront of helping them to attain their needs.
كذلك لابد أن نعلمه إكرام الضيف.
And also it's very important to teach the children to be honorable, to honor the guests.
وأروع ما ضرب من الأمثلة هو سيدنا إبراهيم عليه السلام.
And from the best examples we can give you with regards to this is Ibrahim عليه السلام.
لما جاءه الضيوف الملائكة وكان لا يعلم أنهم ملائكة لم يذبح لهم دجاجة ولا ديك ولا خروف، ذبح لهم عجل وليس أي عجل، انتقى أسمن عجل عنده وذبحه وقدمه لهم.
So Ibrahim alayhi salam, when the guests came to him, and these were angels, and obviously he was not aware that these were angels from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He didn't just present them, you know, a chicken or something very, very trivial, something small, but rather he went for the biggest thing that he could think, which was honorable to his guests, and this was a calf or a cow.
فإذا كنا نأكل على المائدة وضق الباب لا نخفي المائدة تحت السرير.
We should not, as a family, every time, for example, you happen to be sitting on a table, dinner table, and you hear someone knocking on the door. And subhanAllah, the next thing should not be, you know, to hide the plate under the table. So when the guests come in, they find nothing to eat, so maybe they will turn away from you.
ولكن لابد أن نربيه أنه إذا جاء الضيف نخرج له أفضل ما عندنا في البيت ونقدمه للضيف، هذا طاعة لله سبحانه.
So the child should understand that when a guest comes to their house, they should use, or they should give them the best thing they have in terms of food, in terms of drinks or whatever they can provide them, but the best that they have in the house. This is in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost. And this is just an example. And obviously the list, you know, carries on.
فهناك الكثير والكثير من الأخلاق الحميدة التي لابد أن نربي عليها أبناءنا. ولا تنسى أنه في النهاية كل هذا المجموع وكل هذا المردود سوف يعود على الوالدين أولا عندما يكبر هذا الولد، ويعود بالتالي على المجتمع المحيط به. فيقول نعمة التربية يا أبا تميم.
So if we think about this issue, my dear brothers, subhanAllah, the people that primarily they benefit, of course, the children, they will benefit from these noble manners. Even when they go outside, if they when they get older, they will benefit from these manners. And also the parents, they'll also be praised for, you know, for having or raising children with such noble manners. And people will say to them, MashaAllah, you know, what, you know, honorable parents, we've raised children who are upon good mannerisms.
النقطة الثانية في هذا العنصر.
And the second point, and this bullet point.
وأيضا الأب والأم أولا. الأب والأم أولا.
And this is for the, you know, for the parents, the father and the mother, first and foremost.
يربيه على تجنب الأخلاق الرديئة.
They should be very, very cautious of adorning themselves or being involved in mannerisms which are disgraced.
مثل الكذب.
For example, lies.
والسب والشتائم.
And cursing and abusing others.
والكلمات القبيحة والجارحة.
And some of the statements which are known to be very evil and unpraiseworthy.
وهذه رسالة إلى الوالدين.
And this is a message to the parents.
احذرا الخلاف والشقاق والنزاع أمام الأبناء.
Be very, very cautious. This is for the parents. Be very cautious of having, for example, conflicts and fights and disagreements in front of the children.
الذي أدناه التلفظ.
For the least of statements, you can say.
وأعلاه الاشتباك بالأيدي.
And obviously with, you know, hugging or
fighting.
تخيلوا يعني لما الأبناء يشوفوا القدوة الأب والأم. عندما يختلف يتشاجران ويترشقان الألفاظ البذيئة وأحيانا يصل بهم الحاجة يشتبكوا مع بعض وتكون صراع والأولاد يقفون يصرخون أو يشاهدون كل هذا بتعجب.
So when the child sees the parents involved in these sort of conflicts and fights, the children are looking at that, you know, they're observing what's happening, and for them, you know, they're amazed. And what's going to happen? They're going to end up having, to, you know, they're going to end up screaming and shouting because of the incidents that they're witnessing between their parents.
إذا فأنت ربيت في ولدك دون أن تدري أنه إذا واجه أي مشكلة فهذا هو الحل.
So when you're nurturing your child, my dear brothers and sisters, you may not realize or you may not pay attention to certain things, but these children are observing everything that you do.
إن كان هناك خلاف بين الزوجين أقولها وأكررها إنما يتم حل المشكلة في غرفة النوم والباب مغلق والصوت لا يسمع أحد.
So if you have any issue, any disagreement between the parents, for example, the husband and wife, these issues should be taken to the bedrooms, should be taken to the bedroom away from the children, and the voices should be lowered so the children do not hear. What's going on?
وإن لم يصل إلى حل فيكون حكم من 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 الزوج من طرف الزوج وحكم من طرف الزوجة في عدم حضور الأولاد أيضا.
So if it comes to, for example, having to make a decision, then it should be between the father and the mother. Rather, we should not get the children being involved in this.
مهما. الحكم بين حكم من طرفه وحكم من طرفها ويكون الحل بعيدا عن الأولاد.
Okay, so the parents or these, you know, two parents, if they have a disagreement, they should get someone who's upside, either a party from her family and a party from his family to mediate between them, but they should not get the children to be in between.
المهم في النهاية أن الوالدين لابد أن يظهر بصورة دبلوماسية راقية أمام الأولاد. يمكن أن يكون بينهم خلاف شديد، ولكن أمام الأولاد ما في شيء والأمور تسير طبيعي.
So the parents should always show a very good picture and a praiseworthy picture in front of the children, even if within themselves they might have conflicts or disagreements, but the children should not be observing this.
المصيبة الكبرى أن أحياناً بعض الوالدين يستشهدون بالطفل لما يأتي حد للإصلاح. يقول تعالى يا محمد أمك عملت كذا، وتعالى تعالى إبراهيم أبوك مش عمل كذا، ويشركون الأولاد. تخيل الولد يشهد على أبيه والبنت تشهد على أمها، وهذه إن الله وإن الرجل.
So in some cases you find some of the parents, they use the children to sort of intermediate, you know, to become mediates or to mediate between the parents. So if something happened, for example,
to be used as a witness.
To be used as witnesses for incidents that have happened. So for example, the parent might say, look, oh my son, come and see what your father's done, or come and see what your uncle has done. And this is a big, big problem, because then the children are going to start taking sides. Which side are they going to be on, the mother's side or the parents or the father's side?
الكارثة الكبرى أن يكون داخل البيت فريقين. نادي الأم ونادي الأب. Father club, mother club.
And one of the biggest calamities you have is in a family you have a split, where you find one side of the family, they are with the father, and the other side, they are with the mother. As the Sheikh said, the mother's club and the father's club.
Now, نادي الأب يحاول استمالة أكبر عدد من الأولاد ممكن.
So, for example, the mother, she will try to take as much, a bigger portion of the children to be on her side.
ونادي الأم يفعل ذلك.
And also, the father will do the same thing.
وعندما يقول الأب افعل كذا يا بني، الأم تقول له يعني كبر دماغك لا تعبأ بما يقول.
So if the father was to say to one of the children, you know, do this, the mother straight away should interject and say, no, don't worry, leave him, let him do what he wants to do.
كل ما أذكر هذه كوارث في التربية.
So every time these things become apparent when you're nurturing your child.
إذا أراد الطفل شيء ذهب إلى أمه فقالت لا لن أعطيك، ما يصير، ما ينفعش.
So for example, if one of the child wants to go to her mother, for example.
فيذهب إلى أبيه يقول له يا أبي أريد كذا. وأمي قالت له قالت لي لا، فيقول له يا فلانة دعيه يفعل.
So say for example a child went to the father and she said look I wanted this and my mom refused for me to have it, and then the father straight away interjects and says no, meaning speaking to the mother, then he says to the mother no, leave him to do what he wants.
البيت داخله اتحاد. الأب والأم يشكلان شيئاً واحداً. إذا قال الأب لابد أن الأم تستجيب، وإذا قالت الأم لابد أن الأب يستجيب. وإن كان هناك اختلاف في وجهات النظر، مرة أخرى يتم التشاور والتداول في الغرفة. يا أبو محمد أرى أنك أخطأت اليوم في هذا القرار، لماذا يا أم محمد تقول له كذا وكذا؟ يقول لها لا والله أنا وجهة نظري كذا وكذا، وفي الآخر يصل إلى نتيجة ويكون هذا اتفاق.
So my dear brothers and sisters, when it comes to issues like this, where there's some sort of conflict, the house should always have a consensus. They should be upon one opinion. Say for example, if the father was to disagree with anything that, you know, maybe the mother, you know, she wanted to do, this should not be made apparent in front of the children. So rather, this is something that should be taken back either in a bedroom, and they will sit down. For example, they will have the discussion and say, look, maybe the mother should say to the father, to the husband, that I don't agree with the opinion or how you handled the situation. I think you made a mistake. And then the father, he will say, okay, subhanAllah, maybe I wasn't aware of the actual matter in detail. But the end result should always be where they even, it should all come together in this, in agreement of what should be done.
إذن هناك لائحة منظمة لعلاقة الأفراد داخل الأسرة. وما يصير وما لا يصير وما يصح وما لا يصح. هذه اللائحة تم كتابتها بمعرفة الوالدين، ولا يجوز أن يطرأ تعديل على هذه اللائحة إلا بعد اجتماع مغلق بين الوالدين يتم تعديل هذا القرار أو نسخه بقرار جديد.
So there should be policies within the house that are set policies that are within the house that run the house, for example. And these are things that are always going to govern this house, no matter what. And if there's anything that needs to be changed, this should be coming from both parents. It should not be that, you know, the children deciding what goes and what doesn't. The parents have to come to some sort of agreement between themselves, and they can choose to say, look, maybe we should become a bit more lenient or should leave this, for example. But this has to come from the parents.
كل هذا نتكلم عن هذه النقطة الهامة، النقطة 23، غرس الأخلاق الحميدة في نفس الأولاد.
And this is just under this bullet point of the 26th bullet point of how to instill honorable manners within the child.
فتجنب الأخلاق الرديئة مثل الكذب والسب والشتائم والكلمات القبيحة عندما يكون البيت يدور في هذا الفلك الذي وصفته الآن، إذن هذه تربية عملية للأولاد أن هذا ليس موجود، وبالتالي هذا ينعكس على سلوكهم مع الأقارب والآخرين والمجتمع.
So when the family or the parents they abstain from using foul language or mannerisms that are dishonorable, then this will internally have an effect on the children and also it will have an effect on the people outside.
النقطة الثالثة في هذا العنصر قراءة بعض الأحاديث التي ترغب في مكارم الأخلاق وتنهى عن سفاسفها.
And one of the most important points under this subpoint is reading to your children, creating a moment in your day to read to your children some of the ahadith that honor some of the hadith that, for example, that emphasize having honorable manners and anything that is in opposition to that.
ودائما اربط بين توجيهاتي وبين الادله مع الادله الشرعيه، اربط بين توجيهاتي مع الادله الشرعيه، واصل عند الولد انني دائما اتكلم من خلال قال الله وقال رسول.
So you can give them an example, for example, some of the directions you want them to take, but also not just your opinion, but you're also giving them evidence from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they understand that this is not just your statements, but rather you're speaking from revelation.
وأننا يمكن أن نتفاوض طالما الأمر فيه ساعة، أما إذا كان الأمر واجب من الله أو من رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم فما علينا إلا أن نقول سمعنا وأطعنا.
So you make them understand that when it comes to the affairs of Islam, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger have legislated, then we have no option but to listen and obey.
واضح؟
Is that clear?
No. If it's opposite, then they can be me.
Okay.
إذا كان غير واجب لا بأس التفاوض.
أن الأمر إذا كان ليس واجبا لا بأس من التفاوض، يعني فرق بين التفاوض والجدال. يعني مثلا أنا أقول لولدي لا تفعل هذا، يقول لي وأنا أفعل وفعلت وأصدقائي يفعل، هذا جدال. لكن عندما أقول لأبي يا أبي ممكن أعرف ما السبب، يا أمي ممكن أعرف ما السبب، هذا يريد أن يتعلم، فهنا أقول له لأن هذا خطأ من الجهة الشرعية في كذا وكذا، أو خطأ من الجهة العرفية في كذا وكذا وكذا، فتكون قناعته أفضل ممن يكون أمر ديكتاتوري من قبل الأب أو من قبل الأم.
Now, so just to clarify, you know, when there is an affair, for example, that is being disagreed upon, say, for example, from the children, it should not be an issue whereby the children they will say to the father, no, I don't disagree with this. I don't want to do this. This is lack of respect, you know, towards the parents. But if a child is nurtured and if there's anything that she disagrees with or he disagrees with, rather she should speak to the parents. That, for example, she would say, or he would say to the parents, I think maybe this is the better option, or I think maybe there's a better way to do something like this. So this manner
the person needs to be educated, or the children need to be educated how to approach their parents, how to speak to their parents, because this can cause problems between the children and the parents.
واضح كده نكون قد انتهينا يعني باختصار وإيجاز من هذه النقطة غرس الأخلاق الحميدة في نفس الأوقات.
So inshallah ta'ala we'll just summarize. I think we'll finish with just this bullet point of having to instill honorable manners within the child.
لأنه في الحقيقة كل إناء ينضح بما فيه.
Because every vessel it will become clear, it will shine because of what is inside it.
فإن كان فيه عطر نضح العطر.
So if there's anything which is clean and pure, then it will obviously it will also reflect in this vessel.
وإن كان بداخله شيء سيء نضح هذا الشيء.
So if there's anything impure and filth, then it will have an impact to what is seen from outside.
العنصر الجاي طويل ولكن لا لا يعني أنهينا هذا العنصر ولكن في نحن نتكلم كيفية تربية الأولاد. تكلمنا اليوم عن العنصر السادس والعشرين ولكن العنصر السابع والعشرين كبير.
The Sheikh is saying we finish with this 26 points, but then if we move on to the 27th point of how to nurture our children, then this is going to take even more time.
فنتكلم فيه غدا إن شاء الله السابع والعشرين.
So inshallah we'll speak about the 27th point tomorrow.
كان باقي خمس دقائق فقط على موعد الحلقة.
I think we only have about 5 minutes left.
ماشي. أي سؤال؟ أي سؤال؟
Is there any questions?
مفيش. ده شيء كويس إن إحنا عندنا ما عندناش أسئلة معنى كده إن الفكرة وصلت والأمور تمام.
ممكن.
يستحون.
أنت تسأل.
أنت تسأل والكمبيوتر يجيب. لا يعني أصله لأنه سألت يعني يكون كثير يعني أسئلة كثيرة لكن أنا أهم حاجة عندي أن الفكرة وصلت ولا لم تصل. نعم.
So I think the most important thing with the Sheikh is more, you know, is more concerned about people understanding what we've discussed. What does anyone remember what the point we've discussed today? The bullet point 27, the 26th point.
Oh, so to correct the key aqidah in the child, in their heart, instead in about knowing the fear and the love of Allah for the 26th or the 25th point. That was the one before.
26.
So today 20, was the nurturing.
26.
So the honorable.
It's still honorable manners inside the children.
Yeah.
نعم
إن شاء الله. تقول إيش؟ تقول حاجة مهمة الشيطان إنسان.
A question was about 3 weeks ago.
3 weeks ago. أنا عندي مسؤول يعني. ثلاثة أسابيع.
Three lessons back. It's regarding the Sheikh said that if you know that you cannot take the responsibility of getting married because you're gonna have maybe 4 kids, 6 kids. You shouldn't. But if, let's say you call your desires whatsoever, but then you know at the same time you cannot take the responsibility of taking care of the kids.
I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do this. امسك نفسك.
هو يعني الزواج فطرة، يعني الإنسان قبل على أنه يتزوج، لكن أنا مش بقول أنه يمتنع، ولكن بقول أنه لابد أن يتعلم وأن يعمل بما تعلم. يعني هناك وظيفة أنت تريد أن تعمل في هذه الشركة، وهذه الشركة تطلب مواصفات معينة، أنت تذهب وتأخذ دورة وتتعلم لغة وتفعل كذا، وممكن تأخذ شهادة كاملة 3 سنوات مثلا لكي تستطيع أن تدخل هذه المؤسسة، تؤهل لكي تدخل هذه المؤسسة. فالإنسان يفعل هكذا. أهم وظيفة في الحياة تكون الأسرة. فكما أن الإنسان ممكن يصرف آلاف مؤلفة من الجنيهات من أجل أن يحصل على حتميات أو شهادات أو خبرات من أجل أن يفوز بالوظيفة، فهذا أدعى وأولى أن يفعل هذا قبل أن يتزوج. الزواج يا جماعة ليس لكل من هب ودب يذهب يتزوج، هذه مسؤولية. يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نار، هذا طوق من النار في رقبتك. فأنا لا أقول لا تتزوج، ولكن أقول تهيأ وتربى وربي نفسك واختار الزوجة الصالحة ثم تزوج.
نعم. Just in response to the previous question, I think is a very important point. The Sheikh mentioned in the last few lessons that people should not, people should not be hasty in getting married if they are not willing to take on the responsibility of having to raise, you know, righteous children or to instill in them honorable manners, for example, to nurture them about, you know, upon Islam. The Sheikh, in reply to that, he did not mean to say that you should not get married, because getting married is from the fitrah. Is from something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for us to get married so we can reproduce and have children. But what the Sheikh is saying, that a person should learn and understand the responsibilities that come with marriage. Similarly, as if you wanted to do, for example, a job or to take on a career, you would make sure that you learn everything that you need for you to do that, for example, that specific job or whatever it is that you're going to be doing. Even if it means having to go to university to get a degree or to get some sort of qualification or to get some training so you can attain or so you can do that specific job, you would do it. But what about when it comes to one of the biggest responsibilities of having to raise a child? Why are we not willing to learn and understand what it requires for us when it comes to marriage? So the Sheikh is saying, don't just go and get married for the sake of getting married, because that is a big responsibility that's going to be in your neck. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, all you who believe, save yourselves and your families from the hellfire. And how are you going to do that? By learning how to protect your children, how to instill in them the correct mannerisms, how to nurture them in the right way.
فما الفرق بيننا وبين الأنعام؟
So the Sheikh said, if we were to just to get married for the sake of getting married, to fulfill our desires, what would make us different from the animals that do the same thing?
هذا الفرق بين الأسرة من البهائم وبين الأسرة من بني البشر.
And that's the difference between a family from the animals and a family from the humans.
تمام؟ كده فينس فينس بلغة سيف فينس أسأل الله العلي القدير جل وعلا من الذين استمعوا القول فاتبعوا أحسنه سبحانه وتعالى محمد إن شاء الله لا إله إلا الله أستغفر الله وإليه جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.